Honorable Gurbir Grewal, our Attorney General here in the state of New Jersey.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you, Robin, for that introduction. I see a number of members of law enforcement here today. I want to just start by thanking them. Today is National Law Enforcement Appreciation Day, and public safety, so many issues that we deal with on a daily basis to include bias crime, so many social issues that we deal with to include the addiction crisis that we're dealing with in this state. These guys are on the front lines, these men and women are on the front lines, and I want to just take a moment and thank them for their service. So thank you guys. In just a moment, you're going to be hearing from three of our county prosecutors. Prosecutor Robertson from Somerset, Prosecutor Kearns from Hunterdon, and Prosecutor Burke from Warren. These gentlemen do tremendous work day in and day out to keep their communities safe and to address the issue that we're going to speak about this evening, and that's bias incidents and how we report them, how we recognize them, how we respond to them in this state. And later you'll be hearing on that same topic from so many other presenters, including Philip Freeman from the Division of Civil Rights, from the Division of Criminal Justice, David Leonardis, Andy Johns, and I think Brian Christensen as well. In addition to that, we have Dave D'Amico, the president of the New Jersey Bias Crimes Officers Association. These folks are experts in this space, and I don't want to steal from their presentations. I've seen those presentations before, and if I take away all their topics, they won't have anything to say when they get up here. What I do want to talk about is an experience that I had as a county prosecutor. When I first started, before I became Attorney General, I was a county prosecutor in Bergen County. And I want to talk about a case that I dealt with as a county prosecutor, because I think it really drives home this evening's topic. And I want to bring everyone back to the winter of 2011, December time period, going into January of 2012. It was around the start of the Jewish holidays in December of 2011. And in Bergen County, we were dealing with something that we had not really seen a lot of in the past. And it started off small. It started off small, not in the impact, but in the type of conduct. And it started with graffiti. And it started with graffiti at a synagogue in Hackensack. And someone had painted a swastika on the walkway leading up to that synagogue. And they had painted the numbers 8-8, which is a white supremacist symbol for 8, is the eighth letter of the alphabet is H for Heil Hitler. And that's what HH was. And it was reported. The synagogue did the right thing and reported that to local law enforcement, and it was documented. But what was particularly troubling is that the folks who saw that graffiti were the children who were going to the daycare at that synagogue the morning after the vandalism was done. And so law enforcement documented what took place. They filed an incident report, and you know, everyone moved on. The graffiti was cleaned up. A couple of days later, the same thing happened, this time at a synagogue in Maywood, also a daycare facility as well. But in addition to the graffiti, the rabbi there also smelled something that was off. It was odd. And it was an accelerant someone had put on the back of the synagogue. Nothing had been burned or lit, but you could smell the chemicals. And so that was documented. It was in two different towns in Bergen County within a matter of weeks. Fast forward to early January. This time, law enforcement responded to a synagogue in Paramus, and they saw aerosol spray cans of hairspray along the front of a synagogue, and they couldn't make anything of it. But as they looked in the woods around that synagogue, they found a bicycle, and that bicycle was full of Molotov cocktails in the front basket to that bicycle. And whoever was there, I think, had thought about throwing those Molotov cocktails at those accelerants at the front of the synagogue to create a fire. It was documented by law enforcement. The investigations kept going. None of these cases were tied together at that point. There were three incidents of hate in Bergen County. January 12th, 2012, a rabbi, his wife, his five children, and his two parents were asleep in a home right next to Temple Beth El in Rutherford. And they were awoken by the sound of glass breaking. And that sound of glass breaking was someone throwing Molotov cocktails into the wooden house in which they were staying right next to Temple Beth El. And as the screams started from within that bedroom where those Molotov cocktails were hitting, the Molotov cocktails didn't stop. The person throwing them kept going. And five or six or seven and a fire started. And luckily, it didn't get out of control. The family was able to escape. And so now law enforcement was piecing together four incidents of hate across Bergen County. And they were trying to figure out, were these connected? And as the investigation continued, what happened was you also saw the effects of these acts of hate on the community, not just on the Jewish community in Bergen County, but on all faith communities, on all communities, because folks were afraid to go to their houses of worship. Folks were afraid to send their children to daycare facilities that were housed in these houses of worship. And the detectives at my office did something. They looked at the Molotov cocktails that were used in the Rutherford firebombing, and they compared them to the Molotov cocktails that were recovered at the Paramus location, unexploded. And they asked themselves, this person was on a bike, meaning that, you know, he's not driving around or she's not driving around collecting these items. Maybe they're local. And where locally can you find this particular type of bottle? Where locally can you find this type of motor oil that they were using? Where can you find these types of bandanas? And they determined in that location there was a Walmart that sold all of those items. And they were able to piece together those pieces of evidence and then go to that Walmart and say, hey, did you have somebody who bought all of these items? And through great police work, they were able to identify a video image of the individual buying those items. And after they got that video and identified that individual, they identified his co-conspirator. And within a matter of weeks, they arrested an individual named Akash Dalal and another individual named Anthony Graziano. And in 2016, those two individuals were tried on domestic terrorism charges for their conduct. And they were charged with bias intimidation and tried on those charges as well. And after a lengthy trial, they were convicted, each of them, on all charges. And then in July of 2017, they were sentenced. And they were sentenced to 35 years imprisonment each, 32 of which are subject to no early release. And the reason we sought that sentence was to send a strong deterrent message, not just in Bergen County, but throughout the state, that we have no tolerance for this type of conduct in New Jersey. So that was conduct in 2011 and 2012 that was prosecuted in 2017. But I think it shows a number of things. It shows the impact that this type of conduct can have on faith communities. It shows how this type of conduct can escalate from graffiti, from words, to violent conduct and potentially dangerous conduct, but it also shows the critical role that the men and women of law enforcement play in investigating and prosecuting these crimes, the role that these county prosecutors play in sending strong deterrent messages through their work. And what it also shows is that we should be concerned in the moment in which we now live, as we see numbers of bias incidents increasing from 2016 to 2017 to 2018, not just nationally, but in New Jersey as well, and double-digit increases when it comes to incidents of anti-Semitism during that same period of time. And what it should show you is that those comments can lead to conduct, that when we see images of people carrying torches and protesting at college campuses and yelling, Jews will not replace us, yes, there's tolerance and limits on free speech, and yes, there's certain conduct that comes with our price of citizenship that we pay as Americans. But we have to remain vigilant because those comments can lead to conduct, as we've seen in the case of Dalal and Graziano, as we're seeing across this country, because that protest also led to the killing of Heather Heyer just a little bit over a year ago. So we have to remain vigilant. And so what can we do? I think one of the most important things we can do is come together like we're coming together this evening. saying that there is no place for hate in New Jersey, that there is zero tolerance for this type of conduct in this state, that together in this state, law enforcement, community, faith leaders are coming together to figure out how we could recognize, how we could respond to, and how we could report these types of bias incidents. Because it starts with reporting. Because if someone had not called in that first incident of graffiti, if that wasn't put into a database, if the second incident wasn't put into the database, if it wasn't all pieced together, Dalal and Graziano might have continued with their plans. And so it starts with each of you learning and bringing back these messages to your communities on what we are doing and what each of you can do. And it also continues with each of us to do our jobs, to send these messages through the work that we're doing through our investigations and our prosecutions. And I think if we continue to do that, continue to have these types of dialogues, and we're having these dialogues all across the state because it was important to me to make this a point of emphasis, to have community meetings and build this type of trust across the state so we could together root out this type of conduct. So I want to thank each of you for being here. I want to introduce now my partners in this because I don't do it alone and I can't do it alone at the Attorney General's office. We have 21 incredible county prosecutors, each of whom are the chief law enforcement officers in their counties, and each of whom are taking these messages to the communities in their counties with meetings like this one on this topic and on so many other topics to build trust and accountability and to build partnerships that really make our community safer. And I think no one is doing that better, and I don't want to single him out, but he's a good friend of mine, a former colleague of mine, from the U.S. Attorney's Office, then Mike Robertson, your Somerset County Prosecutor. So I want to introduce Mike. Thank you so much.
I usually don't have to follow the general, so he stole all my thunder. So I am the prosecutor of Somerset County. Thank you all for being here. Thank you to Raritan Valley for hosting yet another good event. I would like to echo much of what the Attorney General said, and in particular, something that I've taken the initiative to do, which is very simply getting to know one another, right? I think a lot of the causes of what these things we see, whether it be in the state, the county, or on a national level, is a product of just flat-out ignorance and not knowing each other. In Somerset County, I see Father Ron Pollock in the back. We have, along with others, formed an interfaith coalition, just consisting of different ethnicities, religions, creeds, colors, you name it. And in part, it's just simply getting together and getting to know one another and what each other's concerns are. Because no matter what your background, your ethnicity, your religion, we all have the same concerns about our family, our friends, our kids. And the example that Gabir gave, I don't think, certainly not adults, but no certain uncertain circumstances should any child have to walk to their daycare or their school and see such a visceral sign of hate. That's just unacceptable, no matter where you live. So myself, along with my counterparts, I'll introduce Anthony Kearns from Hunterdon County and Richard Burke from Warren. You know, you have our undivided attention on this issue. We treat it extremely serious. And we just ask, as always, for your involvement with this topic and any others that concern all of us. So I'll introduce Anthony Kearns, Hunterdon County Prosecutor.
Thank you, and good evening and thank you for being here. It's a great thing that law enforcement has. We have tremendous relationships with each other, and we value those relationships, and we appreciate the General's leadership in bringing us together tonight to discuss this very important topic. I couldn't help but think when the General was speaking to think about the Declaration of Independence, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that's what we in this country have grown to know and to appreciate and to rely on. But when somebody is the victim of a biased crime or hate, it really calls into question their ability for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And I think law enforcement, we hold firm that we took an oath to preserve and protect the Constitution and protect everyone under our in our jurisdiction and under our purview. And I can tell you in Hunterdon County, and I know I speak for Warren, Somerset, and the rest of the state, Law enforcement has no time, no tolerance for bias and for hate, and so we're happy to be here tonight to be speaking about this, and we want people to live their lives free of it. I do have two people from my office tonight, liaisons. They are the bias crime liaisons, Pete Pfeiffer, Sergeant Pfeiffer, and Detective Vanessa Jimenez. They're here with us this evening. And in Hunterdon, I feel that we're in very good hands with their productivity and what they're doing on behalf of all of our people in Hunterdon County. So thank you again. Thanks law enforcement for being here tonight, as the general said. And together, I think we are going to make a great difference. Thank you.
I'm just going to walk up here. Nobody introduced me. I'm Richard Burke. I'm the prosecutor in Warren County. One of the problems with coming after these three gentlemen is that they pretty much said it all. But what I just wanted to say was something I thought about when the general was talking is that some of the things you're going to hear tonight have to do with the Attorney General guidelines and protocol that had put in place really many years ago. I think back in 1994 was probably the first protocols that were put together, and they've been updated, and I think we're expecting a new one in the next month or so. But one thing in those guidelines that the police are told, and I think we found in other aspects of law enforcement is very important, is the importance of community involvement. We've kind of took a little roadmap from Hunterdon County and started a group called One Voice up in Warren, which is really a compilation of religious leaders to get together on a quarterly basis to talk about issues that they see and the things that we see. And I've been amazed about the information that we've received as a result of that. It's been a tremendous experience. These are the people I consider to be on the front line, so to speak, and know what goes on a day-to-day basis. But what I've found is we've learned a lot of things that we really might not have known on the law enforcement side from people that see these kind of things every day. And these guidelines and protocols that the law enforcement are now obligated to follow can only really work if we have community involvement and have some discussions with people in various parishes and in various synagogues and in every community that help us root out these types of hate crimes. Because many times they happen when nobody's around or that we have no place to even start. So a lot of the information that you all can give us is very, very important. So I hope what you hear tonight is very informational, and we're here for any questions. The only thing else I would mention is that we also have a bias crime liaisons in our county. They weren't able to make it tonight, but I have plenty of business cards. I'm going to leave here for Lieutenant Timothy Young in our office, who is our liaison, and he will be able to handle any questions or problems that happen in Warren County. So, again, thank you for your time, and enjoy the evening.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Dave Leonardis, training outreach liaison with the Division of Criminal Justice, which is part of the Attorney General's office. So it's great to see such a good turnout tonight, and welcome, and we're glad that you're here. Tonight you're going to hear about bias crime versus bias incident versus First Amendment rights. You're also going to hear about how to recognize, respond to, and report a bias incident. So we have some great speakers that are going to cover that. In New Jersey, we have a very comprehensive bias incident reporting system so that if a police officer gets called to a school or any other place because of a report of a swastika or a racial slur being painted on a wall, that officer, in addition to the normal reports that they have to fill out, they are required to fill out a supplementary bias incident offense report. It's a separate report from everything else. And under the Attorney General's guidelines, the new guidelines, as you heard, are going to be coming out, or the updated version will be coming out shortly. Under those updated guidelines, that report has got to be submitted within 24 hours. And we are working on we actually have a new reporting system in place that we've been piloting so that when that officer reports or submits that supplementary bias incident report, it will automatically go to the New Jersey State Police Uniform Crime Reporting Unit, to the Division of Criminal Justice Bias Crimes Unit, to the respective county prosecutor's office where the offense occurred, and it's also going to go to the New Jersey Office of Homeland Security and Preparedness. As you heard from Attorney General Graywall earlier, sometimes there's a nexus between what looks to be maybe a somewhat minor bias incident and terrorism. So New Jersey Office of Homeland Security and Preparedness will, and all these other agencies that I mentioned, will compare the information to whatever they have on file. The New Jersey Office of Homeland Security and Preparedness also is a repository for SARS, that's suspicious activity reporting. So they compare, you know, all that information with anything that's going on throughout the state. But the important thing that you should know is that all these agencies are working together. In addition, at the end of every working day, besides going to those four agencies I just mentioned, that bias incident report, every incident report, will go to the bias crime liaisons in every county prosecutor's office so that that liaison can view it. Maybe there's a nexus to something that's going on, that occurred in their county, that's going on in another part of the state. And also to be able to give everybody a consistent view of what the bias landscape looks like for New Jersey, kind of put us all on the same page. So, you know, we work very closely together, New Jersey Office of Homeland Security Preparedness, John Page is here tonight, and with the, we also work with the FBI on these matters too, in some cases. And tonight, Arnold Adams from FBI is here with us also. So it's a very comprehensive system. And as I mentioned, when it goes to, I can tell you when it goes to the New Jersey Division of Criminal Justice Bias Crimes Unit, everyone gets scrutinized. You're gonna hear from Detective Brian Christensen in a little while. And I know because Brian's part of our office, every incident that comes in, he reviews it, see if there's a nexus to anything that he's seen before. If it's something that may appear to be unusual or if it appears to be egregious, then, you know, he'll pick up the phone and call his partner at the county prosecutor's office. And if it is something that is egregious, you know, in some cases, the two agencies will work together. There's six incidents or six times when a surrounding a bias incident when the Division of Criminal Justice Bias Crimes Unit has to be notified immediately. So first is if there's a bias incident that involves a murder, or secondly, bias incident involving aggravated assault, incident involving sexual assault, an incident where the suspected perpetrator is a police officer, if the incident is actually perpetrated by an organized hate group, and then sixth, if that incident has a, you know, the potential for wide scale unrest. So any one of those six incidents occur, the Division of Criminal Justice will get notified immediately. And, you know, I know in the past, the prosecutor and the director from Division of Criminal Justice will be on the phone talking to each other, coming up with a game plan. So we have, as you can see, we have a very comprehensive program. You're going to learn a lot tonight. The other thing that you should be aware of, and I'm probably interested in, obviously many times, many of the bias incidents are perpetrated by juveniles as well. So in those cases, you know, sometimes bias, in many cases, unfortunately, prejudice, bias, it's because of ignorance, as we all know. And sometimes those things are learned in the home, unfortunately, brought to school, and kids kind of feed off of each other. So our office, New Jersey Bias Crimes Officers Association and Department of Education are working on an anti-bias training program for school students, you know, to try to nip things in the bud if we can. So with that being said, I want to introduce our next speaker, a good friend, Phil Freeman. Phil is the Assistant Director for the Division, New Jersey Division on Civil Rights. He's going to cover laws against discrimination, give you a little bit of background when they deal with schools and housing. So with that said, Phil Freeman.
Good evening, everyone. On behalf of our director, Rachel Rayner Apter, I am very pleased to be here this evening. It's always a pleasure to work with the Division of Criminal Justice and prosecutors throughout the state. And our work in jurisdiction is a bit differently than what the Office of Bias Crimes covers. The New Jersey Law Against Discrimination covers unlawful discrimination in the areas of employment, housing, and places of public accommodation. We are indeed the oldest and most have the oldest and most comprehensive anti-discrimination laws in the country, and I'm very proud to say that. What I wanted to speak about briefly with respect to the jurisdiction that we cover and how it more so relates to bias-related incidents and bias crimes, involves the areas of housing discrimination, where we receive complaints against the real estate industry based on allegations of steering, blockbusting, redlining, and source of lawful income. We have an intake process where we effectively screen individuals to determine whether or not they have a basis to file a discrimination complaint. If they do have a basis to file, then we investigate those claims. We have forums that enable us to determine what facts are in dispute and certainly address and focus on the allegations that are most relevant to someone's complaint. Once we, through direct evidence and other types of investigative techniques, and we even do things like testing to determine whether or not we validate someone's claims. We look at circumstantial evidence as well. So the sum total of our investigation will enable us to determine, or at least have a reasonable suspicion as to whether or not the law against discrimination has been violated. If we find that it has been violated, then we issue a finding of probable cause. We attempt to conciliate those matters, and if we're not able to do that, then we may go before the Office of Administrative Law. The administrative law judge will make a determination, and the director's order ultimately will be signed off on by our director, who has the ability to either accept, reject, or modify the administrative law judge's decision. In addition to housing claims, we also have jurisdiction over bias-based bullying in public schools. So if a student alleges, or their parents on behalf of that student alleges that they've been discriminated against because of their race, their sex, their religion, their disability, sexual orientation, national origin or nationality, or disability, we have jurisdiction to investigate those claims. In school districts, the pattern normally represents what a student will be subjected to in terms of hostile environments and the behaviors of other students who, whether or not it's intermittently or systemically, subject the student to bias-based bullying because of who that student happens to be. We also look at whether or not and how effective a school district responds to those types of complaints. And we firmly believe that school districts have a duty to respond with prompt remedial action to address the allegations of a student or, and parents. Unfortunately, we don't see that often enough. So again, bias-based bullying is something that we're very concerned about. There are times when my agency may not have jurisdiction over a claim, but it may fall into to the scope and jurisdiction of the Division of Criminal Justice or prosecutors, in that it may very well be a bias-related incident or a bias crime. So in those particular cases, we'll refer to our sister agency, the Division of Criminal Justice, the Bias Crimes Unit, and certainly prosecutors within that respective county. But finally, I want to emphasize the importance of our agency to do and to be committed to a more comprehensive community outreach type of opportunity. And that is where we appreciate this kind of collaboration, and we certainly would appreciate working together with all of you, the organizations or agencies you represent, county government, and of course, criminal justice. Primarily, we normally provide training in terms of numbers to employers more so than community groups, other organizations that are outside of the employment specter. But we're committed to growing. I like to refer to it as a grassroots operation of sorts, a very comprehensive grassroots type of training. For communities throughout the state. So we are certainly welcome to collaborate with all of you. And finally, I always take an opportunity to extend an opportunity to you to refer cases to us, even if you think that it may constitute a violation of the law against discrimination. Or you may know of someone who believes that they've become a victim. We encourage you to contact us, refer those individuals, and keep us abreast of any discriminatory trends that you believe may be prevalent in your communities. We have a website that is, and I'll give that to you, it's www.njcivilrights.gov. So with that, once again, I'd like to thank you. And I'd also like to introduce our next speaker, which is Dave D'Amico. Dave is the president of the Bias Crimes Officers Association, and he's one of the greatest trainers that I've ever seen. And I think you'll find his presentation very informative. Thank you very much.
Thanks for setting me up there, Phil. Good evening, everybody. How are you guys doing? Can you hear me? All right. Such a pleasure and an honor to be here this evening. As Phil said, my name is Dave D'Amico. I'm currently the chief investigator for the Middlesex County Department of Corrections, but I come to you today with over 29 years of law enforcement experience, starting my career at Rahway State Prison. After about 7 years in jail, I decided I wanted to get out. Retook the civil service test. I passed. I became a police officer and detective in the city of Asbury Park. And then after 7 years there, lucky number seven, I was lucky enough to be a member of the Monmouth County Prosecutor's Office and a detective in the Bias Crime and Community Outreach Unit. 2015, I retired. I moved to Fort Lauderdale, Florida, my vacation destination. And after 4 months of being bored, I got on the job there and I became a deputy with the Broward County Sheriff's Office before being recruited back here to be the chief at Middlesex County. I'm also lucky enough to be the president of the New Jersey State Bias Crime Officer Association, a partner with all the agencies here today. So thank you for being here. I'm going to start talking about the first topic in the three R's, recognize. It's recognize, respond, and report. So recognition, I think, is one of the important parts. And I want to say that I don't know if you noticed it, but when you were coming in, I was in the back of the room. And I was kind of watching everybody and listening to everybody, watching who you sat next to, watching who you were having your discussions with and trying to listen. I was doing that with a purpose and a cause. I wanted to prove a point. And the point that I wanted to prove is I am going to guarantee with 100% certainty, 29 years of law enforcement experience and 49 years on this earth, that there is no hate in this room. I get to see hate on a daily basis. It's not happening in here right now. But even though I guarantee, and we're going to talk about hate, even though I guarantee there's no hate in this room, I'm also going to guarantee that everybody in the room, including me, is prejudiced. Now, I didn't say that you're prejudiced towards any of the topics we're going to discuss today. Race, color, religion, gender, disability, sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, national origin or ethnicity. But I did say that you were prejudiced. Who can tell me the definition of prejudice? This is the interactive part, folks. Yes. Oh, I like that. Secluded. I like to start off with that. Anybody else? I like that. You have a feeling against something. I like that. I like both of those. I'm going to break it down, and I'm going to use the Webster's version dictionary, right? Dictionary version. To prejudge, right? That's to look at something or someone. Know absolutely nothing about that person or that thing, yet you start to formulate an opinion that's in your head. Now, I'm going to prove to you that you're all prejudiced, right? Because just like when you came in the room, I was watching you. You were doing the same to me. You had no idea who I was. You had no idea what I was going to talk about. You had no idea about Dave D'Amico. Yet, when you first saw me, you started to formulate some opinions. Now, nothing is going to hurt my feelings. What were you first thinking when you first saw me? Standing in the back of the room, watching you, listening. Go ahead. I'm from Guatemala. Wow, that's a good stereotype. I like that one. What? Why? Oh, it said it up there. Okay, I like that. Anybody else? Yes. I look like a cop. You know, I got to tell you something. There is, and I told you it's 29 years I've been a cop, right? There's nowhere that I go that somebody doesn't say, that's a cop, right? And what is it about me that says cop? Haircut. The haircut, right? The haircut, definitely. But I'm looking at a lot of guys in the room that have the same haircut as me, and you're not law enforcement. So that's a stereotype. What else? The way I carry myself, the cheap JCPenney suit that doesn't fit anymore. Right? Yeah. The belly, right? All those things, right? Cop, it says cop. The way we walk, the way we talk, the way we present ourselves, it says cop, right? Sometimes people automatically, when they first hear me, they say my voice, right? And I got to tell you, you know, when I was back in sixth grade in Piscataway, where I grew up in a school, in a township, small township, Piscataway, and I went to a middle school called Quibbletown. And in sixth grade, I've had this voice from sixth grade. You know what happens, men in the room, you know what happens around sixth grade, right? Puberty hits and strange things starts happening to your body, right? Well, mine, it was the voice. And in sixth grade, the other students started to call me all kinds of names. They started to call me Froggy. That's not that bad, right? But by eighth grade, I became Deep Throat. Very inappropriate, very inappropriate. Now, I will share with you this, but let's take a look as an example of my voice. Some of the things we do as we're immature, we learn as we mature, they actually become benefits. And I'm not here to talk about my voice, but let's talk about diversity that's in this room, right? Every skin color, all different religions, all different ethnic backgrounds, different sexual orientations, and pretty much the majority of us are getting along. People want to divide us by what our outward appearances are. I always say, I teach college at Brookdale Community College and in a college in New York City, and I always want to bring my students to the county morgue for a trip. The college president always says, absolutely not, you're not doing it. But I want my kids to see the medical examiner lay a black body next to a white body and a Hispanic body next to a Jewish body and a Jewish body next to a Muslim body and a gay body next to a straight body. And then I want that medical examiner to cut them all open in front of my students. And what do you think they're going to see? The same thing. So the point is we have more in common than we do not, yet we choose to pick our outward appearances and expressions to prejudge each other. And that's the whole point I'm trying to make. So I want to start off by letting you know that my presentation, my port is not warm and fuzzy, right? We're not going to hold each other's hands and sing Kumbaya. That's not going to happen in the first 25 or 30 minutes. I'm going to start off by showing you a very short video clip, 4 minutes long. The video clip is entitled The History of Hate in America. Matt, if you can get the lights. And The History of Hate in America gives us a little bit of an understanding into what this video clip means. And what it means is we're going back into history. 4 minutes long, and this video clip was put together by law enforcement for you. to touch your value system. Who can tell me what your value system is? What's more valuable to you, right? And how do you get your value system? Is it the way you were raised? Your parents play a role in it. Does your skin color play a role in your value system? Yes. Does your ethnic background play a role in your value system? Does your sexual orientation play a role in your value system? Everything that makes you you plays a role in how you see something that's valuable, right? So the point I want to make with that is we can all be looking at the same thing, yet we see something so very different. So as you watch this video clip, I want you to do me a favor. Remember, history of hate, ugly. Not freedom, not democracy, not the things we want to keep on moving forward. This is the ugliness. What makes you sad? Your warm and fuzzy side. I want to know what makes you angry. I want to know what pisses you off about this video clip. But most importantly, I'm going to challenge you, folks. I want to know if you can understand what it's like to walk a day in somebody else's shoes. Now, what do I mean by that? If you're white, I want you to think about what it's like to be black. If you're black, I want you to think about what it's like to be Hispanic. If you're Hispanic, I want you to think about what it's like to be Asian. If you're Asian, pick one. If you're Christian, I want you to think about what it's like to be Jewish. If you're Jewish, I want you to think about what it's like to be Muslim. If you're Muslim, I want you to think about what it's like to be Sikh or Hindu. If you're a male, I want you to think about what it's like to be a female. If you are a female, I want you to think about what it's like to be a male. If you're straight, I want you to think about what it's like to be gay. If you're gay, I want you to think about what it's like to be straight. Folks, that's a challenge. But every day, I put the badge on my belt, and all these officers out there put that badge on their uniform or on their belt or wherever they may put it. They go out there and they enforce the law, and they took an oath. And that oath is to protect and serve everybody, not just the people that look like them, not just the people of the same religion, the same skin color, the same ethnic background, the same sexual orientation. So we are trained to understand what it's like to walk a day in somebody else's shoes. I want to know if you can understand it. Let's take a look at the video clip, and then we'll discuss it. Remember, history of hate in America.
The hate cry is not rational. It wasn't done for any reason.
Crime is an assault on the very tenets of American democracy and the Constitution that this country cherishes.
Today, America still struggles with intolerance. Today, America still struggles with those who hate. Some still prefer to use the familiar method and retain the old symbols. Others have chosen to use the respectability of public office. Others, the popular pulpit of religion.
What I promote is, bashing them, and the thing is to get away with it. That's the trick, getting away with it. If you can do it without getting caught, you should do it.
I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
We cannot stand by idly while perpetrators of hate think for 1 minute that they will find an easy target on which to prey.
Most dangerous crimes are hate crimes. And if the society doesn't do anything about it, that society will reap the negative results. And the society that does care will reap the dividends.
Very mature video clip for a very mature audience. So please tell me, what touched your value system? What made you sad? What made you angry? Most importantly, what made you think about walking a day in somebody else's shoes? Who'd like to start? I saw your faces and your heads were shaking as you were watching it, and you turned to your neighbor in a brief discussion. What were you talking about? Yes, thank you. There's a lot of, and that's focused and takes a lot. Matt, you could leave those lights off during my presentation, if you don't mind the fluorescence. Thank you. Yeah, you're absolutely right. It takes a lot of energy to focus on that negativity. I like that. Anything else? Yes?
The sight of the little boy.
Yeah. The little kid in the KKK outfit, right? What does that tell us, right? That kid never had a chance. I want you to think not too long ago when you were crawling around in diapers on your living room floor, when you were a baby and you were an infant, were you biased? I can't hear you. Were you prejudiced? Did you stereotype anybody? So it's fair to say we're not born with a gene of hate. How does it happen? It's learned behavior. And who do we learn it from first? Parents. Now, I'm not going to talk about yours, but I'll talk about mine. My parents didn't always say nice things about somebody that wasn't my skin color. My parents didn't always say nice things about somebody that wasn't my religion or my ethnic background or my national origin or my real or perceived sexual orientation. So the first place I learned that was from my parents. Then I went to school. What about our peers? Do our peers teach us bias, prejudice, stereotypes? Right? Because whatever happens at home happens on the school bus, in the lunchroom, in the locker room, when the parents and the adults aren't around. Then the kids leave school, they go home, they turn the TV on. Does the media teach us bias, prejudice, stereotypes? You ever watch South Park? Do they ever say anything nice about anybody on South Park? Right? Now, I've got no problem with you laughing at cartoons on a fake TV screen. Right? But what about when you that kid takes that joke from the TV screen and brings it into the classroom? Or posts on social media? Then we start having problems because now people are affected by those comments, right? And then our kids get bored with TV and they stick the listening device in their ear and they listen to their favorite music. I'm gonna pick one, just one, multi-billion dollar artist, hero, leader, and role model to a lot of young adults. You ever hear Lil Wayne? You ever listen to Lil Wayne's music? According to Lil Wayne, the lyrics of the music, if you're black, you're a nigga. What's up, my nigga? How you doing, my nigga? If you're white, you're a cracker. If you're a female, you're a bitch or a hoe. If you're gay, you're a faggot. It's in the lyrics of the music. So what am I trying to say to you? Heroes, leaders, and role models, I just gave you a title, but you deserve it. Somebody's looking up to you. Whether it's a younger brother or sister, family member, your own kids, I'm looking up to you tonight because you're here and you don't have to be here. And that tells me that you care. So I'm looking up to you. Somebody's looking up to you. So we have to ask ourselves, what do we do collectively as a society to make sure that that history that we just saw doesn't repeat itself? Because the power and control is in our hands. Now, how does all this happen, and what are we going to do about it? The kids are a great way to start. The other thing that got to you, because I don't have too much time, was the black man hanging from a tree, right? We know a lot about that photograph. It's in social studies books, history books. It's in the museum in D.C. Black man walking down the street, Selma, Alabama, 1927, doing nothing wrong. They didn't know his first name. They didn't know his last name. He did nothing to precipitate the event. No fight, no argument. Because of one thing and one thing only, the color of his skin, they beat him up. They snatched him up, they took him to that tree, they put a noose around his neck, and they murdered him in front of everybody. Now, if all you saw was the black man hanging from a tree, you have what we call in law enforcement tunnel vision. Tunnel vision will get you killed. That's when you're looking at what's in front of you, and you forget about what's going on around you. Because there was a lot more going on in that picture other than the ugliness of the lynching. The guy who committed the homicide, he stood there. He pointed to the victim, and he let his picture be taken. What does that say about somebody that commits an act of hate? Proud of it. Is proud a value system response? Absolutely it is. He was proud of what he did, so proud that he let his picture be taken. And what was even more disturbing in that photograph, and more pertinent to the individuals, heroes, leaders, and role models in this room, is what was going on underneath the black man's body. Common, average, everyday people came out of their homes, their schools, their place of business. They marched down to that tree, they watched this man get murdered, and nobody did anything to stop it. And then I have to look in my own mirror and ask myself, here we have a homicide, the perpetrator's on scene saying, I did it, tons of physical evidence, the rope, the body, and tons of eyewitnesses. Where the hell were the police? They were in the picture. They allowed it to happen. So we, modern law enforcement officers, recognize that we have to rebuild that bridge of trust between the community and law enforcement. That's why we need you. That's why we're so happy that you're here to partner with us in this mission to reduce this bias, to recognize it, respond to it, and report it. So how is hate spread differently in your generation than it was back in 1926, 27, 28? Social media, right? All your kids have it, right? Facebook is the oldest one. I'm still on it because I can't run the other ones. I don't even know about Twitter or whatever that is, right? And all the other things. But Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, they're all on it. And the number one recruitment tool for organized hate is social media. And the number one recruited are kids ages 12 through 21. Why 12 through 21? They think they can change their minds. They can set into motion a thought process that makes them think differently. And sometimes they're very successful at doing that. How does hate happen, and what are we going to do to stop it? Right here, we put together what we call the pyramid of prejudice. It is a pyramid. Everything in life starts out with a foundation, just like this one. And the foundation of hate is very simple to understand. It's ignorance. Now look, heroes, leaders, and role models, if we knock this out, I guarantee you hate will never happen. Guarantee you. But if we don't, and we take the ignorance that we've been taught, and we spread it, it starts building this pyramid and moving up. And the next block is when we take the ignorance and we spread it amongst people that we know and trust. Very indirect. Rumors, jokes, comments, innuendos. We allow them to be said in front of us. We do nothing to stop it or correct it. And we allow it to happen, or even we repeat it. Now look, heroes, leaders, and role models, you can stop it right there. But if you don't, it moves up to the next stage. And the next stage is the avoidance stage. This happens early on in life, too. I want you to, again, go back and think back to when you were in middle school, in elementary school. I don't want that kid sitting at my lunch table. He's one of them. She's one of them. I'm not picking that kid to be on my gym team. He's one of them. She's one of them. Hey, I'm not getting dressed in front of that kid in the locker room. He's one of them. She's one of them. It's where we, human beings, take other human beings and we start putting them in categories of us versus them. Heroes, leaders, and role models. You can stop it right there. But if you don't, it moves up to the next stage. And the next stage is the exclusion stage. This is where we actually start to exclude people from our lives based on nothing more than ignorance. This was never more prevalent than days after September 11th. Do we remember that? Right? Who was responsible for September 11th? Osama bin Laden, right? Front page of every newspaper, every television station. What was Osama bin Laden wearing on his head? A turban. What religion was Osama bin Laden? Muslim. Where did he come from? The Middle East. So what did a lot of Americans start to do? They started to point to people that looked like bin Laden and say, get out. You don't belong here. Go back to your country. We don't want a mosque in our neighborhood. We don't want you running our 7-Eleven. We don't want you pumping our gas. And these are actual crime statistics off real police reports. Right? So it's very clear when our value system is touched, it's very easy to fall somewhere into this pyramid. Now, what you're looking at is a pyramid, but it's also shaped like a volcano. And if we, the heroes, leaders, and role models, don't do anything about it down here, it's going to cross this point of no return. We call this the point of no return because down here is a bias incident. You'll hear more about this from Chief Johns. A bias incident, right? Let me ask you guys a question, the audience that are non-law enforcement. Can we go out today and lock up everybody that's ignorant? Might as well put the handcuffs on me. Can we go out today and lock up everybody that spreads rumors? Can we go out today and lock up people that avoid people at no cost? Can we go out today and lock up people that exclude people from their lives? So law enforcement's hands are tied here, right? But we need the community, and we need community organizations to say no, to say it's not going to be acceptable in our community, and we need you to report it. Because once you report it, then law enforcement can take some action, even though it's not arrest. Because we know that if we allow all this crap to happen and we do nothing about it, it's going to move up to the next stage and cross this point of no return. And that's an actual hate crime, also known in New Jersey as a bias crime, the crime of bias intimidation. Every single bias crime that's ever been committed, and the general talked about one in Bergen County not too long ago, start off at the bottom of this pyramid and work its way up to the top. Sometimes it takes minutes, sometimes hours, sometimes days, sometimes months, but every single bias crime, when you look at the motive, when the law enforcement detectives, first responders, law enforcement officers look at the motive, it's always down to ignorance. Now look, if we do nothing about bias crimes, it moves to the pinnacle, the peak, the top. Now, what you're looking at is a pyramid of prejudice, how it happens from ignorance to hate, but what you're also looking at is a blueprint of history. Whose history is this? Bin Laden. It is. It's his, right? And guess who else? Adolf Hitler, from the bottom to the top, right? And let me ask you guys a question, heroes, leaders, and role models. Did Adolf Hitler or Osama bin Laden kill anybody? No. They got other people to do it for them. That's what's so scary about this pyramid. That's what's so really important to recognize about what's going on around us, what other people are doing. If you see something, it's important to say something. If you see something, it's important to pick up that phone and look all local authorities. If you see something that's out of the ordinary, it's important to let somebody know so that we can look into it and see what's going on, because this could happen in our own backyard, as it has in New Jersey in the past, tomorrow, if we do nothing about it, because history will repeat itself. Now, I don't want to talk about up here, because guess what? Ignorance is nothing more than fear. Fear of the unknown. Fear turns to prejudgment. Prejudgment turns to hate. Hate turns to violence if we do nothing about it. Once it gets up here, we respond to it. We react to it. I want to talk about down here, where the heroes, leaders, and role models in the room can put a stop to it. And I want to share with you a story about a young kid whose name was Ahmed. Ahmed decided, based on the bottom of his pyramid one day, to take all the books out of his book pack. He filled his book pack up with rocks and a cinder block to make it really heavy. He put that book pack on his back, and he walked out the front door of his home. And he walked for a mile carrying that heavy book pack without thinking twice about turning around or stopping or asking for help, until he got to a local bridge and he jumped off and he committed suicide. Now, suicide's not an option for any one of your loved ones, because they have you, a hero, leader, and role model. And if something like this is happening to somebody you know and they tell you, you'll stop it. But Ahmed, he didn't think like he had the support network that's in this room right now. So Ahmed, that day, took his own life. Now, Ahmed left a 7-page suicide note. Ahmed's brother David is going to read you portions of that note. And as you listen to that note, I want you, the heroes, leaders, and role models, I want you to think about where this happened, who was responsible for doing it, who, if anybody, did anything about it. Now, Ahmed was only 12 when this happened. It happened now 19 years ago. Some would say, Dave, why are you showing a 19-year-old video clip to a current presentation? Well, I want to prove a point. Yes, this happened 19 years ago, but right here in New Jersey, just a couple years ago, a young student named Tyler Clemente drove his car from Rutgers University to the George Washington Bridge, and he jumped off and he committed suicide. You see, heroes, leaders, and role models, history will repeat itself unless we do something about it. Ahmed's brother, Dave, is going to read you portions of his suicide note. You have to listen clearly to his parents because they speak with a heavy accent.
First thing is, Ahmed's story. I love you, Mom and Dad, but you didn't understand why I had to commit suicide. There was so much going on, and I tried to cope with it, but I couldn't take it anymore.
In the morning when I wake up, I think Ahmed is alive, and the reality hits me that he's not here anymore. I don't want to get out of the bed, and I don't want to get up and come downstairs, and it's hard to accept. I don't know about my husband and other family, but I haven't accepted. Yeah.
We come thousand miles to this country to our life be safe and peaceful, you know. But look at what happened, and 1,000 miles far from war. We never know where we should go to be safe, you know.
School is the main reason. It was horrible. Every day I was teased and teased. everyone calling me gay, fag, queer. And I would always act like it didn't bug me and ignored them. But I was crying inside. It hurt me so bad.
I asked him, you came to the bridge, did you walk all this way, and you never change your mind? If you had that much pain, why you didn't share with us, why you didn't tell us?
This counselor told me when she came to talk to our class about suicide that usually the person committing suicide gives hints. I gave you guys many hints, but it wasn't your fault. You didn't understand. I love you, Mom and Dad, and especially you, David. I have to mention this. Please make people stop name-calling and teasing other people, because it really hurts. That's just my only wish, and I hope people will listen to me. Please, visit my grave often, so that I am not lonely.
A 14-year-old young man closed his 7-page suicide note with a sentence. Please visit my grave often so that I am not lonely. Can you imagine the pain that Ahmed was going through? Where did this happen? In school. Who did it? Other students. Who did anything about it? I can't hear you. Nobody. Ahmed said something very important to his heroes, leaders, and role models, his teachers, his guidance counselors, his parents, the school resource officer. He said, I gave you hints. I gave you many hints, but you didn't understand. You know what he was trying to tell them? They didn't know what it was like to walk a day in Ahmed's shoes. They didn't know what it was like to come to school every day and be targeted and bullied and picked on because he was perceived to be gay. And that's the ironic part about Ahmed's story, is we'll never know if Ahmed was gay or not because he's dead. But this is what we do know. Ahmed was a straight-A student, never absent from school. Ahmed had a role model. Ahmed wanted to be an actor when he grew up. So he went to school every day, never absent, and got straight A's, even though this torture of bullying was going on based on his sexual orientation. But Ahmed, he didn't join the football team. He didn't join the soccer team or the wrestling team or the basketball team. No, Ahmed at 14 joined the drama club. What stereotypes come along with a 14-year-old young boy that joins the drama club? Must be gay. Ahmed died and took his own life because of stereotypes, because of the bottom of the pyramid, because of ignorance. And he told his heroes, leaders, and role models. And you know, it's funny because myself, just like all the other law enforcement room, we have guns on. I have a loaded Glock 40 caliber on my ankle ready to go. And we're trained to be proficient with those weapons. Twice a year, we have to qualify. We have to be proficient. We have to understand the consequences. We have to know what happens when we pull that gun out. Because let me ask you a question. I pull that gun out, I point it, I pull the trigger, the bullet comes out of the barrel. Can I take the bullet back? No. So I better damn well train with it. I better damn well understand the consequences of it. I better damn well understand what happens when I choose to take that gun out of the holster. Well, I'm here to tell you, heroes, leaders, and role models, words are like bullets. You shoot those words out of your mouth, they have consequences. Or you can say, I didn't mean it that way. Let's ask Ahmed's parents if I didn't mean it that way means anything. Let's ask Tyler Clemente's parents if I didn't mean it that way means anything. There's another reason why I chose this video clip. Because I get to see the bias reports every day. And I see the reports coming in. And I want you to imagine we are in a professional setting. We're in an unbelievable college with 3 county chief law enforcement officers right in the front listening to everything we're saying and participating and putting this together. Now I want you to imagine this. Somebody walks down the hallway saying that ugly, derogatory, disgusting word nigger, or spick, or kike, or dothead, or wop, or cracker, or any of the other disgusting words that I mentioned before. What's going to happen in this room? What do you think is going to happen? Heads are going to turn. Somebody's going to do something. Somebody's going to say something. Somebody's going to stop it. I work in a jail right now. I teach at 2 colleges. I go out to eat a lot. I shop at the mall. I listen to people. People aren't saying that stuff walking down the hallway. But what do I hear every day where I go somewhere? Oh, you're so gay. Oh, you're such a fag. Hey, you're a good-looking dude. No homo. Right? And guess what happens? Nothing. You know what that tells me? Somebody that's investigated bias, somebody that's in charge of the Bias Crime Officer Association, somebody that's involved in law enforcement, tells me that we've made those words acceptable. Let's ask Ahmed and Tyler if those words are acceptable. We have to recognize that the bottom of the pyramid is just as important as if it starts to grow up to the top. And words have meanings. Words have meanings. And if they hear the hero, leader, and role model saying them, they think it's okay. And more importantly, if the hero, leader, and role model hears them and doesn't stop it, they think it's okay. They think they can get away with it. So it's very important to recognize our obligation. And what's our obligation, right? The general talked about the nexus to terrorism. That's the definition of terrorism: use of force, threat of force to intimidate, right? People who commit hate do it for a reason. Hate crimes are message crimes. They send a clear message. Think about this. If somebody burns a cross on a black family's front lawn, is it really only about that black family, or are they trying to send a message to everybody else that's black? Right? If somebody puts a swastika on a synagogue, is it really about the building, or is it about a message to all the Jewish people that you're not welcome here? If somebody hangs outside of a gay bar or a gay establishment and waits for people to come out and beats them up, is it really about those two victims, or is it about sending a message to the LGBT community that you're not welcome here? Hate crimes are message crimes. So we have to recognize what we have to do. And what we have to do are the three R's. As Dave Leonardo said, recognize. That's my part. Respond, Chief Johns. Report, Detective Christensen. So recognize real quick, I'm not going to steal Chief Johns' presentation, but it's important to recognize there is a difference between a biased incident and a biased crime. He will discuss that in totality, right? That's the definition of biased incident. Biased crime in New Jersey is called biased intimidation, but the key element of that biased intimidation for the law enforcement officers in the room is that we have to prove that the victim was intimidated by the actions of the perpetrator. So the definition of intimidation is very important. And it is also important to recognize, as Brian will tell you, that this requires a police response above patrol, because detectives are gonna be called out to take a statement from the victim. And hopefully, under Miranda, a statement from the perpetrator. So we have to prove intimidation. It's real important to talk about victimization quickly before I give it over to Chief Johns. And when we talk about victimization, I want everybody in the room that's ever been the victim of a crime to raise their hand. Right? Somebody broke into your locker at the gym, somebody stole your bike, somebody broke into your house. Any one of those crimes, we all know, they're horrible, they're devastating, you feel violated. But all those crimes could have been prevented. All of them. Think about it. Lock your bike in a well-lit area with a chain lock on it. Don't put valuables in a gym locker. Get an alarm for your car, park it in a well-lit area. Put a fence around your house, put lights up, buy a dog, buy an alarm system. All of those crimes possibly could be prevented. What can the victim of bias do to prevent it from happening? Nothing. They walk out the door and there's a target on their back and they have no idea when that target's gonna get hit. And until we collectively as society and law enforcement together as partners do something, they are gonna continually be worried about victimization. That is why it's more emotional for victims of bias crimes. And I mess this one up every time I give the presentation, but it went somebody wrote a poem a long time ago and it went something like this. A month ago, they came for the blacks, but I'm not black, so I don't care. 3 weeks ago, they came for the Jews, but I'm not Jewish, so I don't care. 2 weeks ago, they came for the Mexicans, but I'm not Mexican, so I don't care. Last week, they came for the gays, but I'm not gay, so I don't care. But tomorrow, they're coming for me. And who's left to help me? Because everybody else is gone. The whole point of that tier system of victimization is understanding that we are all the victim of bias if one of us is selected. Because today it's them, tomorrow it may be you, and we have to do something to see something, to say something, to stand up, to recognize it, to respond it, and it's gotta be reported. Because once it's reported, law enforcement officers can take the steps necessary to put a stop to it, whether it's at the bias incident stage or whether it rises to the level of a bias crime. Who commits bias incidents and bias crimes? Everybody. The number one perpetrator are young adults. As Dave Leonardo said, juveniles and young adults ages 12 through 21. Why? Because this is learned behavior. They learned it. And why they think they can get away with it? Because guess what? Young kids don't worry about consequences until they get caught. That's when they worry about it. And then, of course, members of organized hate groups. And you're going to be very lucky today, tonight, because you have somebody who's going to present to you later on today that's actually infiltrated an organized hate group. He was an undercover skinhead, Detective Christensen. He's going to talk to you about reporting. Who are the victims? The number one skin color, and it's black. Why number one? Why skin color and why black? I only got a couple minutes left, but I'll tell you what. I come in this room, and I'm a perpetrator, and I want to pick a victim. Can I look at you and tell what your religion is? Can I look at you and tell what your ethnic background is? Can I look at you and tell what your race is? No. Can I look at you and tell what your sexual orientation is? Uh-uh. But what's the most identifiable characteristic? Skin color. And why is it black? History. It's a learned behavior. White people weren't hanging from trees. White people didn't have to use a different water fountain. White people didn't have to sit a different place on a bus. This is learned, taught behavior. Number two is religion. And even though there was a rise of crimes against Muslims, Sikhs, and Hindus post-September 11th, it never rose to the level of Jewish people being targeted. Why Jewish people? Learned behavior. Adolf Hitler, Nazi Germany, World War II. It is learned behavior. And the number three is a direct tie between two groups. And that direct tie is based on UCR reporting. Between the Hispanic community, right now, targeted specifically what is perceived to be Mexican immigrants, and the LGBT community. Let me ask you here as leaders and role models a question. Do these two members of communities, do they feel like coming forward to law enforcement, do they feel comfortable coming to us and reporting crimes? No. So we need your help. If you see something, you gotta say something. And as the AG just talked about, the general, he said the FBI numbers just came out. They're there in front of you. You can look them up online. Very important to understand. They categorize the classes a little bit different than we do in the state, but these are new statistics for 2017, and it shows the same thing. Hate incidents and hate crimes are on the rise. And the only way we're going to put a stop to it is if we work together as partners, as a team. And it has been my absolute privilege and pleasure to speak with you this evening. And it's even more of a privilege and pleasure to introduce our next presenter, my very good friend, Chief Johns. Thank you, Chief. So, Matt, could you flip over those screens for us, please? Thank you. And thank you for making me look so good, Matt. I appreciate it. Give this guy a hand clap. Thank you so much. Thank you. Oh, thank you, sir. Thanks for having me. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you for helping me out in the front. Appreciate it.
Good evening. Can you all hear me? So thank you, Dave, for the introduction. Like he said, my name is Andy Johns. I'm the chief of the Specialized Crimes Bureau at the Division of Criminal Justice. I'm a prosecutor, and within the Specialized Crimes Bureau is the Bias Crimes Unit. I'm going to talk to you about New Jersey's Bias Crimes Statute. This is a prosecutor's main tool for responding to bias crimes. This is the statute that we use to prosecute them. I'm going to give you the nuts and the bolts of the statute. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what the difference between a bias incident and a bias intimidation crime is. We're going to have a couple hypotheticals. So there is a little bit audience participation, not as much as Dave's portion of the program. And then I'm going to tell you a little bit about why it's important to report these incidents from a prosecutor's perspective, even though it may not rise to the level of being a bias crime for that particular incident. So, first, we're going to do the bias crime versus bias intimidation and talk about reporting. So what is a bias incident? This is not necessarily a legal definition of what a bias incident is, but it's a pretty good working definition. And a bias incident is an act which occurs to a person, a group of persons, or property because of a bias against race, color, religion, gender, disability, sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, national origin, or ethnicity. That's the list of protected classes that comes out of our bias crime statute. It's also the list of protected classes that's in the law against discrimination, what Deputy Director Freeman talked about earlier in the program. Bias intimidation, it's a criminal statute under the New Jersey Code. You'll find it at 2C16-1. If you wanna go home and Google that, the first or second return will be the text of the statute itself. There's the way that we prosecute crimes and we analyze crimes is we look at the individual elements of a crime. And the first element that we're looking at when it comes to the bias intimidation statute is that the bias intimidation crime cannot exist in a vacuum. It has to occur in conjunction with what we could call a predicate act or another crime. And that can't just be any old crime. It's got to be something that's on the list that's already in the statute, okay? And this is the list of crimes that could potentially qualify as bias intimidation offenses under New Jersey law. Some of them are pretty obvious. Homicide, assault and aggravated assault, kidnapping and related offenses, sexual assaults, robberies, arson and criminal mischief. That would be your graffiti offenses would be in that chapter. Burglaries, harassments, and weapons offenses. Harassments is a bit of a special category because a lot of people will call our office if they've been involved in a bias incident or they have a question about why something's not being prosecuted as a bias intimidation because they think it might be a harassment. So in a couple of slides, we're going to talk just a little bit about harassment and that a true harassment under the law is a little bit higher than what you would, in common language, think of harassing behavior, okay? So, after this prosecutor proves that one of those crimes happened, okay, that crime has its own independent elements, we have to prove that the defendant is the person who committed a crime, and we have to be able to prove all that beyond a reasonable doubt. Then we've got to prove these additional elements in order to prove bias intimidation in a particular case. We have to prove that that other crime was committed with a purpose to intimidate an individual or group of individuals, or that the crime was committed knowing that an individual or group of individuals would actually be intimidated. So that's subsection A and subsection B of the statute if you go home and you Google it. You're gonna see in the statute book subsection C, Charlie, that subsection has been ruled unconstitutional because it's been based on the victim's perception of the event. And we can't have a criminal conviction stand on the victim's state of mind. Criminal convictions can only rest on the defendant's state of mind. Okay, so just clearing up some confusion and maybe heading off some phone calls and emails when y'all go home and Google this. And then the last element we have to prove is we have to prove that the underlying predicate offense was committed because of race, color, religion, gender, disability, sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, national origin, or ethnicity. That list of 9 protected classes once again. The criminal penalties for bias intimidation are pretty severe. When the general was describing the prosecution in Bergen County earlier in the program, that number, 35 years, just to give you some perspective, a regular first-degree crime, something like robbery, starts at 10 years, okay? So 35 years in the context of any prosecution that isn't necessarily an actual murder, an attempted murder in that case, anything in that range is an absolute moonshot, okay? That's a big number. And what this statute does is it gives prosecutors the ability to escalate the penalties for the underlying crimes. So for example, if the defendant is charged with third-degree aggravated assault, which is normally punishable by 3 to 5 years in state prison, the bias intimidation crime would be graded as a second-degree crime, 1 degree higher. The penalty for bias intimidation would be 5 to 10 years in that circumstance. So the more serious the underlying crime, the more serious the conviction for bias intimidation. If the underlying crime is already a first-degree crime, such as a robbery, which is 10 to 20 years, the bias intimidation turns into a super first degree, and under New Jersey law, that's 15 to 30 years. So the numbers can get really high because, like the general said, this is serious stuff. You know, the legislature, when they created this statute, did this intentionally because this is such a serious problem for society. And when we can prosecute it, we want it to mean something and we want it to stick. The other thing that the court can order after a conviction of bias intimidation is court-ordered sensitivity training or civil rights training, court-ordered counseling, and also payments or other compensation to community organizations that provide assistance to bias intimidation victims. So what's the difference? What's the difference between a bias crime and a bias incident? Well, all bias intimidation crimes are bias incident, but not every bias incident rises to the level of the crime of bias intimidation. Every case in and of itself is fact sensitive, and the police are going to conduct an investigation to try to suss out as much of those facts as possible. The prosecutor is going to look at the investigation, look at the statements, prioritizing the statements from the victim, from the defendant, and then looking at other sources of evidence that might be out there. Maybe the defendant posted things on social media about their motives for committing a particular crime. Those are the types of things that prosecutors are going to look for. We have to have that predicate offense. If there is no predicate offense, there is no bias intimidation. Okay? So there's got to be that underlying crime. And the most important thing for bias intimidation is we need that proof of the actor's state of mind. We need to be able to prove beyond a reasonable doubt, not just some wild guess, beyond a reasonable doubt that the person did what they did because they intended to intimidate a person or a group, and that they did it based on one of those 9 protected categories. So we're going to do some hypotheticals, okay? And I want some audience participation here by a show of hands. So 2 people who have never met before, they get into an argument over a fender bender in a parking lot. One of them is white and the other is Hispanic. During the argument, the white person shouts a racial slur at the Hispanic person. Bias incident or bias intimidation? All right, show of hands. Who thinks this is the crime of bias intimidation? Who thinks this is a bias incident? This is a bias incident. In this particular instance, we have 2 people who have no history together whatsoever, okay? We have no evidence of motive. You know, it's not like they committed an underlying crime and then they did it because of race or animosity towards a race or national origin or something like that. This is somebody who's probably a jerk who just spat it off at the mouth because they're angry after they got into a fender bender. Okay? So harassment. I did see a couple hands go up because they thought maybe this would be bias intimidation. And you're probably thinking of that because maybe it's based on harassment. Because if you say something offensive like that to somebody, yeah, that's harassing me, right? You might think that. But the harassment statute's a little more complicated than that. And this is our harassment statute. So if a person with purpose to harass another person, that's important. Purpose is the highest mental element that we have in the criminal law. That means we need to prove that a person fully intended and knew it was going to be the outcome of their action that they were going to harass this other person. Okay? So purpose is the first obstacle in prosecuting a harassment. Makes or causes to be made a communication or communications anonymously or extremely inconvenient hours or an offensively coarse language. That may be true, but we're missing the purposeful element here, remember? Or any other manner likely to cause annoyance or alarm. I want to highlight this or any other manner language that really doesn't mean or any other manner. There's a court case out there that essentially says the method has to intrude on the other person's privacy. So 2 people in an argument out in public in a parking lot under the law does not qualify as any other matter making a communication. It's got to be something that intrudes on a person's privacy, banging on their window in the middle of the night. The late night phone call with the heavy breathing. Like, that's what this is about. This is not for a spur of the moment argument over a parking spot between a jerk and somebody who's innocent. And then the second way is engages in any other course of alarming conduct or repeatedly committed acts with purpose to alarm or seriously annoy such other person. Again, it's that repetitious nature. It's that repeated harassment. The late night type thing, the neighbor who constantly is going to his neighbor's house and doing something on that property. That's the kind of behavior that we're talking about for harassment. It's not these one-off random encounters between 2 individuals, even if there is a flavor of bias going on in that incident. Hypothetical number 2, a man who is not gay, is assaulted by a group of young men who shout anti-gay slurs during the attack. The police investigation uncovers evidence that the attackers committed the assault because they wanted to rid their community of gay people. Who here thinks this is the crime of bias intimidation? Who here thinks this is just a bias incident? This is probably bias intimidation. And I brought up this example because it's important to note that the suspects in selecting this person because they thought he was gay, they made what a prosecutor would call a mistake of fact. The person was not actually gay. But under the law, it doesn't make a difference. Because they selected the person thinking that he was gay and did it because they were targeting him to intimidate him, that's bias intimidation, okay? So in this instance, if it's an aggravated assault, we'll say it's a third degree aggravated assault based on the injuries, the bias intimidation would be graded as a second degree crime. And then the last one. This one's a little tricky. Every day, a Muslim man and his neighbor, a black woman, get into their cars to go to work at the same time. Every day, the black woman looks at the neighbor and yells, "Go back to your own country." Who here thinks this is the crime of bias intimidation? Maybe. Who here thinks this is a bias incident? So I see a lot less hands going up. I think, so I accomplished my goal. I made a hard hypothetical here. Again, we got to circle back to the harassment statute. Prosecutor would have to look at this one long and hard before they decided to bring a bias intimidation prosecution in this particular case. They would look at things like, how long has this conduct been going on? I just said every day. We don't know how long every day is. Is every day for a week? Is every day for a month? Is every day for the last 16 years? Right? I don't know, right? We've got to be careful about making assumptions for things that we don't necessarily have the proofs of. And that's what the police investigation is going to do, though. The police investigation is going to suss that stuff out. You know, they're going to look and see what that victim's motives are. Maybe there's other instances where that person engaged in anti-immigrant behavior or anti-Muslim behavior that might change the analysis a little bit, give us a little bit more proof of the motive of the actor in that instance. So, why report? Why report these bias incidents if a prosecutor, somebody like me, can't do anything about a bias incident? You know, I can't stop people from being jerks. Like Dave said, we can't go out and arrest everybody who's ignorant, who wants to act like a jerk, right? Well, the rules of evidence allow prosecutors in certain circumstances to use something that we call prior bad acts or other acts. Things that might not otherwise be relevant to the crime that you're prosecuting. Sometimes you can drag in those proofs from other instances to prove up your current case. And one of those examples is if you can bring in a prior bad act to prove up motive, right? So if we've got an actor and we're just looking at one instance, one specific set of conduct, and it's on the line as to whether or not a prosecutor wants to bring that prosecution, if they also have 5 or 6 documented instances of that individual expressing that particular bias, doing things in potentially an escalating level of behavior, kind of like the general said. That's one of the things we look out for, is like an escalation of behavior. You know, it starts with words and then we move into actions. If the person has that type of documented history, we may be able to use that. But we can only use that if you guys report it, okay? A brief word about the First Amendment. The bias intimidation statute does not criminalize free speech. That I need to be absolutely clear about. As a prosecutor, it's my obligation to not just prosecute crimes, but to also defend the Constitution. And that includes defending the First Amendment, no matter how repugnant the things that said actually are, okay? But again, if it rises to the level of something that you think is worth reporting, report it, because it can become the basis of motive in a later prosecution. Because Speech turns to little actions. You know, speech turns to flyers. Flyers turns into bricks. Bricks turns into Molotov cocktails, which turns into burning down your local synagogue, or whatever the case may be. So those are the types of things that we need to know about. We need to get the information about. It's important to us as law enforcement to know what's going on and to get that information on these actors. That's my very quick nuts and bolts presentation on the bias intimidation statute. I'm now going to turn it over to Detective Brian Christensen. He is an absolute wealth of knowledge on bias crimes in New Jersey, and he is actually going to talk to you about the mechanics of actually making a report about a bias incident or suspected bias crime.
Thank you, sir. All right, so I'm finishing up on reporting. With a show of hands, I'd like to see how many people in here are part of a religious organization. Wow, that's awesome. Okay. Well, I'm going to talk a little bit about a story, actually, that started my whole career in bias crimes. It was a while ago, about 5 orthopedic surgeries and a lot less grayer time ago. So it was in the early 2000s that I was doing a case. I was stumbling across a message board forum, a white supremacist message board forum, and I'm going through this forum and I'm looking at these posts that are getting posted from individuals claiming to be from New Jersey, going on talking about how the night before they were going around beating Mexicans. And they go into detail about what they did. They started saying that they stole things from these individuals. I'm saying, really? What's going on here? So I started trying to figure out where these guys were from. Looked into it, found out where they were from in New Jersey. Started going around to the local towns around there saying, hey, does anyone have unsolved aggravated assault reports? Nothing. I'm saying, something's not right here. So I went back to my boss at the time. I said, what am I missing here? My boss basically said, go out and look at the religious institutions around the area. I said, okay. So I went over to a pastor and around the area. I said, does any one of your constituents, have they ever been victimized? And he says, yes. I said, really? So he brought 3 individuals in. I was able to interview them. It just so happened that one of the individuals matched up the exact description of what happened about a month prior to being posted on that message board forum. I said, holy cow, what's going on? So I started looking at the message board forum going back probably about a good half a year, and this is before I stumbled into it, and they'd been bragging about this for a while. So I was able to then interview probably about 6 different pastors. They were able to provide about 13 different victims. Victims came forward, and they never actually reported these to the police in fear of being undocumented. They said, we can't do this. To make a long story short, we went forward. We were able to turn one of the skinheads who ended up squealing on everybody. We were able to arrest everyone on bias intimidation charges. It was 8 individuals. The highest age was 18 years old, 14 being the bottom. They were committing first-degree bias intimidation charges, 15, 14, 15, 16, 17 years old. So it was amazing. And I always thank religious institutions because you guys are a good source to be able to assist in our cases. So I'm going to show a quick little video. Where is this thing? That NJ.com did about reporting bias crimes.
In 2006, there were 759 hate crimes reported in the state of New Jersey. However, of the 508 police departments in the state, only 225 reported any at all. By 2015, the number of hate crimes decreased to 328. So did the number of police departments reporting hate crimes, dropping to 123. In 2015, the feds estimated that there were 293,000 hate crimes nationally. but there were only 6,500 reported to the FBI. It's impossible to know exactly how many of these estimated hate crimes occurred in New Jersey, but it's safe to say that the number would be measured in thousands, not hundreds.
Yeah, so these stats are always coming out, and they're throwing out these stats of reported crimes, reported incidents. I don't think it's always an actual good stat to rely on. I mean, there's so many unreported stats that are going on. So right here, we can look at the rise that went to 2015, 14%. We have a pretty good repository keeping track of all these bias incidents that have gone through. I can tell you, 2016, 2017, there is a nice rise. 2018, there's a significant rise. So who do you report a bias incident to? If you are a victim, you need to call your local police and let them know so they can file a report. If you don't feel comfortable going to your local police, you have your county prosecutor's offices. County prosecutor's offices have people dedicated to doing bias crimes in every county prosecutor's office. If you don't feel comfortable for some reason going to the county prosecutor's office, we have resources with the Division of Criminal Justice. We have phone numbers right up here, emails that you can send information to. And another option, I know we have an individual from FBI here, you can always call the FBI. They have a manned 24-hour phone right there, and you can make a report. So what do you need to tell the police? It's not good just to say, yeah, I'm a victim of a bias crime. You need to be very specific about what happened. If you're called a racial slur, you have to tell the police what kind of racial slur you were called. The police officer is going to document it in their report exactly what you were called. If you can remember license plates, remember the license plates. If this happened before, but you never felt comfortable telling the police, and you feel embarrassed, tell the police. Say, hey, listen, this happened now. This is about the fourth time this happened. I didn't want to raise a problem before on this, but this is now the fourth time this is happening. Go through all the different incidents that happened. If you have surveillance cameras, tell the police also about that. So what happens after you tell the police that this bias incident happened? Local police officers have to document these reports. This isn't a, maybe I'll put it in a report, maybe I won't. No, they're required. They have to fill out a supplementary bias incident form. This is what it looks like. I'm sure everyone could read that, right? As I turn around, I can't see it either. But it goes in here and lists everything in the entire report. It goes through the type of crime it possibly could be, the victim. In the narrative form, it's going to basically not go into detail about a person's name. It's just going to say the suspect basically did whatever, X, Y, and Z. So what happens after this incident report is done? Local police have their supervisors review this. Say a local police officer tells their supervisor, hey, I had to do a bias incident report. Supervisor will review it, say, okay, we have to make notice to the county prosecutor's office. County prosecutor's office is notified. They have assistant prosecutors that will decide whether or not it rises to the level of bias intimidation or it just stays as a bias incident. They also have to send it to our office as well, the New Jersey Division of Criminal Justice. That is because we oversee everything in that whole chain of what happened. So there's layers here of review. So when a bias incident happens, it doesn't just get brushed aside. There's four different agencies that end up looking at all these incidents. So Dave had covered before when we have to be contacted immediately. We usually, if any of these incidents will happen, we'll come out and respond and assist local, county, police in these investigations. And at the end of it, State Police Uniform Crime Reporting Unit gets sent the report as well. Why do they get sent that report? Because that's who officially tabulates these reports. That's where these numbers come from. So it's got to go to the State Police Uniform Crime Report. When do we get involved? We get involved basically if we have to supersede a case, if there's conflicts of interest. But 9 times out of 10, the county prosecutor's office will always take the case for bias crimes. So we have a reward program in the Division of Criminal Justice. It's up to $25,000 for a bias crime conviction. This is done online. If you feel you're a victim, or you know someone that's a victim, we advocate that you go online and send this in. If someone is found guilty of a bias crime conviction, you can be paid up to $25,000. What's that? If it's a bias crime conviction, and they reported it through us, yes. Here's how you could do it. If you want to take that information down. It's on the flyer, so that's great. Okay. So when we were doing this a couple times ago, I think it was at Brookdale Community College, I'd like to finish with the Attorney General. Gave a great speech in Washington, D.C., about bias crimes, reporting bias crimes, and statistics. That is just a copy, so I can't. Sorry.
I don't think any of us in this room in our lifetimes imagine that we would ever see torch-bearing, hate-filled protesters yelling, "Jews will not replace us," out of all places on a college campus. And I certainly don't think any of us in this room in our lifetimes ever imagined that we would see people being confronted, physically accosted, and even killed for no other reason than what they look like, what they believe, or who they love. From the killing of Shuri Nivas Kochibotla, an Indian engineer who was shot dead in Olathe, Kansas, after a gunman said to him to get out of this country, to the killing of Timothy Kaufman, who was fatally stabbed in New York City by an individual who wanted to kill black people, to the fatal stabbings of Ricky John Best and Talishan Namkai Meshe in Portland, Oregon, who were killed as they stood up to protect two women from an attacker who was hurling Islamophobic threats, to the killing of Heather Heyer, who was mowed down on the streets of Charlottesville by a white supremacist protester, to countless other attacks on mosques, on synagogues, on houses of worship, as well as numerous planned attacks that have been disrupted. These events serve as a stark reminder of how easily that hateful language can find its way back in our public discourse, become normalized, and escalate to physical violence when we choose to ignore it and when we fail to say anything. And as I stand here in our nation's capital tonight, I worry that too many of our leaders have failed us in this regard. Far too many of our leaders have accepted hate and anger and division as a normal part of our political discourse. And I believe that this acceptance is contributing to the rise in bias crimes that I'm seeing in my state and that we're seeing nationwide. And this is directly impacting the safety and well-being of our communities. So the question naturally is, what do we do about it? Well, in part, we push back. We hold accountable those who seek to harm others. As a chief law enforcement official, I will use all the tools at my disposal to protect those in danger. We will bring to justice any person who commits acts of violence against others, regardless of whether they're motivated by hatred of a particular race, religion, or ethnic group. But we must treat an act of hate against any group as an act of hate against all of us.
All right, I want to thank you, everyone, for coming out. I think I'm going to turn it over to Prosecutor Robertson now, basically to lead any questions that anyone has. Yeah. Sir?